chapter, as we observe verse 31, the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse 31. It reads as follows: "But that the world," this is Jesus speaking, "but that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, so I do. Arise, let us go from here." Again, "but that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, so I do. Arise, let us go from here." Our theme, the focus of our studies for this period of time, is the cross. The subject today is obedience. Obedience, obedience. Jesus, at the age of 12, made a statement to his parents. He said, "It is time that I must be about my Father's business." We're talking about obedience, obedience. Jesus personally committed to be obedient to God. It was a personal decision at this particular age, when he had come of age and having grown under the instruction of his parents and learning in the synagogue. He said, "It is time." He was motivated, Jesus, in his life. We looked at last week, Jesus was motivated by love. We also understand that Jesus was motivated in his life, and in going to the cross, he was motivated by obedience also. Obedience. And I want to say to all who are here this morning, to fulfill God's purpose in your life, you must make a decision to give your life to God and be committed to obedience. Be committed to obedience. Whether you're young or whether you're old, the Lord is looking for obedience. Remember, Jesus said, again, at the age of 12, "It is time, it's time that I must be about my Father's business. It's time." So often, unnoticed, we can waste time. So often, unthinking, living life day by day, we can let time pass us by. Sometimes we don't take advantage of the time. The Lord says in his word, we must redeem time, for the days are evil. We, in our quest to try to control time, I'm talking about man, We at different times of the year try to go about setting our clocks forward or setting them back, trying to control time ourselves when we really don't have control of time. Right now we're involved in daylight saving time so that the days will be longer, daylight will be there longer, but church, in reality, time is not being extended. Time is short. Time is brief. Time is passing swiftly, swiftly. Jesus said, "It is time that I was about my Father's business." He committed himself to being obedient to God. That was at the age, again, of 12. At the age of 30 years of age, we find that Jesus did more than just make a statement to his parents. He made a public statement. That is, he arrived on the scene at the River of Jordan where John the Baptist was baptizing, and John the Baptist identified Jesus as the Lamb of God who had come to take away the sin of the world. Right. It was Jesus who confronted John and insisted upon John that John baptize him. Of course, this is what John did. And this helps us to understand what Paul was saying in the book of Philippians, that passage read a little bit earlier, in the 8th verse, that Jesus humbled himself, this is as a man now, and became obedient, still obedient, but even obedient to the point of death. Jesus, being at the age of 30, was baptized publicly. His public ministry was beginning, and he only had 3 years in which he was going to be involved in his mission, preparing for ultimately going to the cross. When Jesus was baptized, we find that the word teaches that the heavens opened and that the Spirit of God descended in the form of a dove, and a voice from heaven spoke and said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." God being pleased with the obedience of his Son. Obedience to God is pleasing to God. Now that's not only referring to Jesus, that's referring to all of us. Obedience to God is pleasing to God. Obedience to God, however, is the very thing that Satan tries to disrupt. That's the last thing that Satan wants you to do, is to be obedient unto the Lord. We find that Satan stepped in Jesus' time. Satan stepped in to disrupt Jesus' plan by tempting him, trying to sway Jesus from being obedient to his Father and be disobedient from going to the cross. Satan knew that if Jesus really did go to the cross, and Satan knew that's what Jesus was planning to do. He knew that that was the plan of the Father. He knew that if Jesus would not get on the cross, if he could do anything, Satan, within his power, to stop Jesus from going to the cross, that the world itself would indeed be lost, would be lost. Satan doesn't want anybody to be saved. Satan's aim is to see you in hell. That's his aim. Satan's aim is for you to join him in hell. All right, all right. He knows that's his destination. He knows that's where he's going. He doesn't want anybody to get away from that. He doesn't want you going to heaven. Satan is doing everything within his power right now to try to bring about disobedience in your life to cause you to lose your soul. Let us look at how Jesus handled temptation. We're talking about obedience and being tempted to disobey. It is Jesus who was tempted after he had made his public statement, after he was baptized, after Jesus let it be known publicly now through the word of John and through his own actions that he was coming to give himself for the sins of the world. The Bible teaches us that he fasted for 40 days and for 40 nights and that Satan tempted him. Satan tempted Jesus at this time to question what God says. Have you ever been tempted in that way? tempted to question what God says, whether what the Lord says, what his word says is really true, whether it's not true, just to question what the Lord says. Satan said to Jesus, if you are the Son of God, because Jesus was hungry now after fasting those many days, he said, if you're the Son of God, command that the stones on the ground be made bread. In other words, what Satan was saying was, the satisfaction of the body is of more importance than the satisfaction of the soul. He was saying, follow my advice. If you can really do it, turn the stones into bread, satisfy what the body wants to have. If you're not careful, Satan can lead you astray, tempting you with such words that it's the satisfaction of our bodies, of our feelings, that is of greater importance than the satisfaction of the soul. But look at how Jesus handled this temptation. Jesus said, it is written, man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. What Jesus was saying here, that obedience is what is of greater importance. He stressed obedience to the word of God. Obedience to the word of God. Satan, the word says, took Jesus up on the top, the pinnacle of the temple, and said, if you're the Son of God, cast yourself down, and he'll send angels to catch you, lest you dash your foot against a stone. What he was saying was, put on, if you're the Son of God, put on an act. Give a performance. In other words, use God. Use God in order to get glory for yourself. But Jesus answered and said, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord your God. He was saying, it is better to be obedient to the word of God, not to use God, but so that God can use you. That's the important part. Satan didn't give up, but he tempted Jesus again, took him up on a high mountain, the word says, and showed him the kingdoms of the world and the glory of all of them, and said, if you will bow down and worship me, all of this, all of the greatness of the world, I will give to you. In other words, just saying, I'll give you everything you can want, whatever your mind can imagine, as long as you don't pay any attention to that three-letter word, and that is sin. Don't be disturbed by the thought of sin. Just worship me. And Jesus said, get behind me, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. In other words, Jesus was saying, obedience to God and God only is what is important in life. The Bible tells us that Satan left Jesus at that time, the word says, for a season. That means that Satan left only to come back at another time. And that's certainly what he did. Let's look at some other areas in which Jesus was tempted. Jesus was tempted to please men, to win their approval, and to enlarge his following. There were those unbelievers of whom Jesus had talked to let them know he was the Son of God. He was letting them know that he was going to a place that they could not come unless they chose to believe in him and to accept him as the Son of God. Jesus could have changed his message in order to please men because they wouldn't accept that. He could have said, well, you can accept it or not. He could have said, if you just want to follow me so we can have a large gathering, so we can have a large following, believe anything that you want to believe. But no, Jesus stayed the course and Jesus in being obedient to his Father, he said to those unbelievers even, that where I'm going, you can't come. But he said, when I am lifted up, you're going to know for yourselves that I am indeed the Savior, that I am the Son of the living God. For he said, I always do that which pleases my Father. It was later, Satan tempted Jesus again. He was tempted to listen to other people and to their opinions rather than to follow God and his word. Has that ever come before you? To listen to other people and their opinions rather than to listen to and follow the word of God. Jesus was saying on one occasion that speaking to his disciples, that he was going away, he was going to suffer, that he was going to be put to death, but on the third day, he would rise again. And it was Peter who said to Jesus, Peter took Jesus aside after he had said this publicly, and he said in so many words, don't talk about something like you're going to be put to death. We're banding together so that we can help you to be the Messiah for this earthly kingdom. In other words, Peter was saying, you're going to be our king, our leader. And here you're talking about being put to death. He said, it's not going to be that way, Jesus. Jesus said to him, get behind me, Satan. In other words, he was saying to Peter, you're letting Satan influence your mind. You're letting Satan influence your thoughts. I know what my mission is. I'm going to be obedient to my Father. And what you're saying that's different from what God says, I cannot be influenced by that. Jesus was motivated by obedience to his Father. He was tempted again to rethink his commitment because those whom he was trying to help, they would turn against him. Have you ever been tempted in that way? Those who you're trying to help are those who you have helped, that they turn against you. All this happened when Jesus, a few days before the crucifixion on the Sunday that we recognize as Palm Sunday, when he was riding into Jerusalem, that the people, the masses, the multitudes were praising him as their Son of David, as their new king, as their Messiah, as their deliverer. But Jesus knew beforehand that in a few short days, the multitude that was commending him and congratulating him would be the same multitude that would cry out that he be crucified. Jesus was tempted to rethink, because of that, his commitment to the Lord. And he said, Jesus said, even of himself, that my soul is exceedingly sorrowful. But he said, what shall I ask? Shall I ask the Father to take this hour away from me? But then he answered and said, it's for this cause I came into the world. I came to give my life, even for those who will turn against me. Jesus being tempted again, tempted to think that those who you love, that they don't love you. He was tempted to think that nobody loves you and nobody cares. Have you ever felt that way? Throwing yourself a pity party, being tempted by Satan to think nobody cares about you, and to ask the question, what's the use? What's the use in being obedient to the Lord and following the standards and the way that God has commanded. So he told his disciples, even in the midst of being tempted, that nobody cared for him. Jesus said to his disciples that the day is coming when you are going to be offended because of me, and you're going to be scattered. Every one of you, rather than standing with me, you're going to go your separate ways for fear of your own life. He said, you're going to leave me alone. But yet, he said, because he was committed to obedience, yet I'm not alone, for the Father is with me. Jesus stayed the course. Jesus was tempted again to fear Satan and to fear the future because of what Satan was about to ultimately do. And that was to unleash every weapon at his disposal upon and against Jesus as the days drew near for him going to the cross. Jesus knew what Satan had in store for him. He knew the suffering that he was going to have to endure, but he continued on anyway, for he said, Satan can only do so much. Satan, the Lord says to us, he may get against you to destroy your body, but he cannot harm your soul if you're committed and if you're obedient unto the Lord. And so Jesus answered, even through that temptation, the words that he spoke again in this 31st verse of this 14th chapter. But that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, so I do. Jesus was tempted again to doubt God. Have you ever doubted the Lord? And to ask God, are you there? And God, if you are there, do you know what's going on? God, if you're on the throne and you know everything and have all power, do you know what you're doing? Don't you see? Don't you care about what's going on? Jesus experienced that. We find even when he was there in the Garden of Gethsemane, on the night in which he would be arrested, the word is teaching us. He said that my soul this time is sorrowful. Previously, he said that my soul is troubled. Now he is saying, my soul is sorrowful even unto death. For he said in his prayers and in his experience, he had taken the disciples with him to pray with him, but they went to sleep. And Jesus had to pray all by himself. That's when sometimes you may be tempted to doubt God. He was saying, nobody understands. Nobody appreciates what I'm going through. Nobody can understand the suffering I'm about to endure, the emotional pain, as well as the physical that is soon to come. And the temptation was to doubt the very power of God. And so Jesus, in his prayer, said, Father, if there's some other way for the world to be redeemed, if there's another way, take this cup from me. In other words, change the plan. Come up with another plan if there's another way. But right after that, he said, nevertheless, not what I will. It's not what I want, but Father, what you will, what you would have me to do. That's what I want to be obedient to. The word says that Jesus ultimately, through those prayers, experienced the presence of an angel that came and ministered to him. Don't you know when Satan tempts you to doubt God, when you're firm in your belief, when you hold on to God's unchanging hand, that God will send the help that you need. It can be earthly help. It can be heavenly help. But God will send the help. The Lord sent help. God sent help to Jesus in his hour of temptation. One final point of Jesus' temptation was when he hung on the cross. And that's when he was tempted just to quit, just to give it all up in his suffering, in his dying hours there. The word says that there were those who passed by criticizing him, ridiculing him, mocking him, making fun of him, and saying, if you're the Son of God, come down from the cross. Save yourself. He saved others, but he can't even save himself. A temptation for him just to quit. Stop dying. Stop giving yourself for the sins of the world. Just come down and get on with something else in your life. But oh, thanks be to God that Jesus stayed on the cross. He hung there, obedient to the will of the Father. He stayed on the cross until he said, "It is finished. I've done, Father, everything that you've asked me to do. I've given my life for the sins of the world. It is finished." And then he said, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." The word says that he gave up the ghost, that he died, hung his head and died for the sins of the world. Talking about being motivated by obedience. Oh, it's so important, church. And that's the example that Jesus gave for us. It's the message of the cross that Jesus gives to us, even today. That when we're following Jesus, when we're taking up our cross, we ought to be motivated by obedience. Oh, because we're going to be tempted just like Jesus was tempted. The word says that he was tempted in all points just like we are, but yet without sin. He was the one who made it all the way through without being disobedient 1 second of his life. He is saying to us, if you're going to follow me, you have to be obedient to my word. You have to be obedient or to the word of God. That's why Paul said again in that second chapter that was read of the book of Philippians that when Jesus humbled himself and became obedient, Paul says also in the verses prior to that, let this mind be in you, which also was in Christ Jesus. In other words, come to a point as to where you think like Jesus thought, so that you can do like Jesus did. Let this mind be in you, that you be obedient unto God. If you're going to carry the cross, let that be your motivation, that you're going to be obedient regardless of what comes, regardless of what other folks say, regardless of what other folks' opinions are, regardless of what Satan comes against you with, regardless of his power and of his weapons, regardless and in spite of what other people might say, that I'm going to be obedient unto the Lord. Or you're going to be tempted to be disobedient, but you got to learn how to handle the devil when he comes against you, as he came against Jesus over and over again. He's going to come against us to turn you around, to tempt you toward disobedience. The word says to us that if you submit yourself to God, you can resist the devil, and the devil will flee from you. Oh, if you want to get the devil out of your way, if you want to make the devil get behind you, oh, you can tell the devil, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Oh, get behind me, Satan. I'm going to do the will of God. I'm going to be obedient unto the Lord. Get behind me, Satan. Don't you tell him to get behind you if you haven't submitted to God, if you haven't humbled yourself before God. Remember, Paul said Jesus humbled himself and became obedient unto death. When James in the 4th chapter says in that 7th verse that you can resist the devil, he says in the verse prior to that, that God gives grace to the humble. You've got to humble yourself. Submit to God, and the devil has to get behind you. You can put him behind you in the name of Jesus. Oh, but don't think he's going to leave you alone. No, he's not that crazy. He's going to come back. If he doesn't come back in your face when you tell him to get behind you, he'll jump on your back to try to pull you down. There's a way to handle him. Even when he jumps on your back, our children sing sometimes that you've got to learn how to shake the devil off. Oh, when he gets on your back, don't take him for a ride. Shake him off. Put him down. Put him in his place. In the name of Jesus. Oh, you can shake him off. Tell him, Satan, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Put him under your feet. You get on with living obediently for the Lord in Jesus' name. Oh, you've got power that you don't know you've got when you're obedient unto the Lord. Jesus did it. He's our example, the perfect example. Oh, we've fallen along the way, but get up again. You be obedient unto the Lord. Give your life to the Lord. Live your life for the Lord. That's what Jesus is saying to us. When you think that you can't go any further, when you think that all is lost, when you think or feel that you're all alone, oh, you keep remembering that the Lord is there. If you're obedient to him, he's there. He's there with you. Just open your eyes. Open your heart. Sometimes all you can say is just, Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help. Nobody else. No other help. That I know. Oh, and there is no other help. There is no other one. It's only God. Only God. He is there for us. Let us be obedient to him. Give our lives to the Lord. Be committed to following in the footsteps of Jesus Christ. The invitation is extended. If there is anyone who desires to come and to give your life to the Lord today, this is your opportunity. Remember, Jesus said, it's time that I was about my Father's business. I'm saying again to young as well as old, take advantage of your time. It's the time that God has given you. Use it wisely. Don't waste it. Don't let time just pass you by. Give your life to the Lord. Be about your Father's business. Be committed to obedience unto the Lord. And then just watch what the Lord can do. I could stand here all day and just tell you what the Lord can do and what he will do. But you know, it's not all in what I say, but it is in what the Lord can prove to you. In your own life's experience, he'll show you. He'll do it. He'll show you. He doesn't act with everybody in the same way, but in some way, he'll let you know, I'm with you. I approve of what you're doing if you're obedient unto me, if you're following in the footsteps of Jesus. Obedience, obedience. Give your life to the Lord. Let him use you. You don't want to use him. Let him use you to glorify him. The invitation extended. If there is anyone desiring to come out of sin, to flee hell, to flee sin, to come unto the Lord, won't you come and give your life to Jesus? If you are without a church home and would desire that this be the church of your choice, the invitation is to you. If you're in need of prayer, we're here to bow in prayer with you. For whatever your needs may be, you too may come. Let us stand. And as the choir sings, as the voices sing the selection for us, this is your opportunity to come. Make a change, make a difference in your life through and by the help of the Lord. Be obedient to him.
Give your life to the Lord.
Every day.